Hello, learners. Welcome back to another session of Geography. I know we've always been hearing the grade 12s programs, rather for the grade 12s, and the grade 11s have always been complaining we don't get any programs. So grade 11s, a big welcome to you. We're focusing on you on these series of geography lessons, and I hope you enjoy them. We try to make them as exciting as possible. Today, what we're going to look at is your geographical techniques and skills, and we're going to look at aerial photographs. All right? I just want to say initially, I know sometimes with aerial photographs, learners really get very worked up. How do we identify? Learners, please note one thing. You've seen aerial photographs all the time, not in the photograph version, but through your eyes. Since you were born, you've been looking at the landscape. You've been looking at different features. You've been looking at it at different angles. So your knowledge and experience of the past is going to be very valuable in interpreting aerial photographs. Let's get going. All right, the key concepts that we will look at in here, we'll be looking at oblique and vertical aerial photographs, and we're going to identify landforms and features. Then we're going to look at how we look at tone, texture, and shadow, and actually identify and interpret features. So tone, texture, and shadow. We're also going to take it further and look at another type of aerial photograph. That's your orthophoto map. And we're also going to identify features there. And lastly, we're going to look at how you orientate the photograph to the map. So orientation of photograph and orthophoto to topographic maps. A very important thing that, or a very important skill rather, that you will be using when you're writing tests, exams, etc. Those are our key concepts that we will be looking at. Okay, let's start. You've done already in grade 10, even in grade 9, you've touched on aerial photographs. Just a rough idea of the different types of aerial photographs we can get. Of course, when we're going through GIS later on in this series, you will remember now that it's gone to a different era. We've got satellites, and satellites also take photographs of the Earth, etc., from the top. We've got a vertical aerial photograph, which takes photographs directly from above. We've got oblique aerial photographs, which takes it at an angle. And we've got our ground level photographs. Very common. I don't even have to go through ground level. You always take a lot of ground level photographs with your cell phone or your camera or at functions. So see, it's nothing foreign to you. You already know many of these things. All right, let's go further. Let's look first at our vertical aerial photographs. Vertical aerial photographs, as indicated here, are taken directly from above. The old way, aircraft flying. Now it also can be taken by satellite. So it's 0 degrees to the vertical. What do I mean by 0 degrees to the vertical? If I look at this diagram, you can see it. It's taken, there's the vertical, and it's taken here. 0 degrees to the vertical, straight from above, just clicked. All right? The best time to take these photographs is between 10 and 1400 hours to minimize the shadows on the photograph. I will show you a little picture later on that. An example of a vertical aerial photograph, you can see from the top, you'll notice the whole area, looking at it from the top. Okay? Let's look at the advantages and disadvantages of an aerial photograph. Firstly, let's look at some of the advantages of vertical aerial photographs. One of them, the scale is the same in all parts of the photograph. Let me look at it here. If you look at this diagram, you'll notice if it's taken directly from above, all the areas will have more or less the same scale. Okay, let's look at a second one. The shapes of objects are correct. Again, if I look at my little photograph and I look at it, from the top, you get a top view or a plan view, and you can look at the shapes, they're more or less the same. I know I have a problem also. Don't forget your magnifying glass, eh? When you're doing the aerial photographs, so you can have a good look and identify your features. All right, let's go on. And objects are not blocked. Again, taking the time period of 10 to 2 o'clock, the objects are not blocked because you're taking it from above, which makes it easier to see the objects. Some of the disadvantages: detail sometimes is obscured by shadows. For instance, if you're taking it a bit later, you may just get a shadow on the picture, on the area, and therefore you may not see certain details. You may get a rough sort of picture of the place, but not seeing the place. And there is too much detail. All right. For instance, features can be too small. If I look at this aerial photograph, can you see the amount of detail there? It's a lot. So you can't really, you know, interpret it 100% to make sure certain things are there. Smaller things will be very tiny. Of course, it depends on the scale of the photograph. If you're having a sort of bigger scale, it will become more clearer. But there's too much detail on that. Okay, so those are the advantages and disadvantages of vertical aerial photograph. Let's look at oblique aerial photographs on the other hand. As we mentioned earlier on, oblique aerial photographs are photographs taken at a view, right, at an angle to the vertical aerial photograph. For instance, if I look at this photograph, you can see the angle. There's your camera, and there's your angle that it's taking it at. Now, this is a low angle aerial photograph or vertical aerial photograph. It's taken at 30 degrees to the vertical. Can you see it? 30 degrees to the vertical. So my angle from there to there is 30 degrees. Okay, you got that? Let's look at a picture of this. All right, you can see down here, 30 degrees. There's your little picture taking a photograph. It'll become more clearer when I show you a low angle and a high angle photograph and compare them. Let's look at the next one. Okay, the high angle photograph. Now, the high angle photograph also taken at an angle, but taken at an angle of 60 degrees to the vertical. All right, let's look at this. Can you see it here? The other one was 30 degrees. Now it is 60 degrees to the vertical. And it's also taken lower down. So let's look at this picture here. All right. You notice you see more detail, not as clear as the low angle vertical aerial photograph, but more detail, and you also see the horizon. That's one way of identifying it. All right, so you see more, not as clear as the low angle photograph, and you also see the horizon. I want to do a comparison between the two again. If you look at this photograph carefully, and also if you go back, and look at this photograph, you'll notice you're not seeing so much of the horizon here, okay? But you're seeing a clearer view of the place. So clearly between a low angle and a high angle photograph, low angle photographs, you don't see so much, you don't see the horizon, but you see more clear pictures. And with a high angle photograph, you actually see more, but not as clear. So you see the horizon, etc. Okay. I want to then look at the advantages and disadvantages of oblique photographs. They provide more common view of the landscape, and we can determine the relative height of the buildings, as shown down here. Can you see? We can see the height of the buildings. The height of the buildings down here. We can see taller buildings, shorter buildings. All right. We can also look at the disadvantages. Let me get back to my little eraser. The size of features are distorted because it's taken at an angle. You can't really see how and make an accurate judgment of how tall a building is or how short a building is, okay? Because it's taken at an angle. We cannot apply scale to this map. I'm gonna go back here. What do I mean by that? Because features nearby will actually look bigger, and features a little further away will look smaller. So applying scale to the photograph won't work that well. Okay, let's go down further. Certain features are hidden by other features. That's another problem that we would have with oblique angle photographs. I'll show you here. Obviously, features behind this building, you may not be able to see. Behind this building, what's behind there, you cannot see, because it's actually blocked by this taller building. So you can't see all, they are hidden at times. Okay, so those are your photographs of different types in terms of oblique and vertical aerial photographs. Now, also, we can use different tones and textures of photographs. Many of your photographs that you will be tested on will be in black and white. You understand, when we print them for exams, etc., they come in black and white. But we can use various sort of aspects to determine what feature it actually is. Let's look at these things. Let's look at tone. Tone actually refers to the brightness and color of a feature. Light tones, such as sand, concrete, and roof, those will be your light tones. Dark tones, such as forest. Okay, let me just show you on a little picture here. If we look at this, these are the trees. Okay, your trees. And they definitely have a darker tone. Let's look at, if we go a little down here, and we look at the golf course down here, and the grass is cut short, it's set out, and look at there, it has a light tone compared to the trees, which has a darker tone. So you can identify different things using your tone. Okay, even down here, the windbreak, the tree here has a dark tone because it's trees. So trees will have a darker tone, cut grass will have a lighter tone. Let's look at the next one. Texture refers to how coarse or how smooth a feature is. Smooth texture would be your grass and soccer field. Rough texture would be your forest. Let's go back or forward to the other one again. If you look at it here, and you'll notice when we look at texture, the trees will have a coarse texture, all right? And when we look at the golf course where the grass is cut, it'll have a fine texture itself. So the texture will change, and you'll be able to identify different features according to the texture. Let's look at shadows, the next one. I'm going to quickly erase this. Let's look at shadows. All right, shadows are cast by the sun's rays shining on an object. Shadows can give you an indication of the height of objects, and it can also tell you at what time of the day it is taken. I'm going to go back a few slides just to show you this. I do apologize for the slide delay. And if we look at this little picture down here. Now, obviously you know where the sun rises and sets. If it's 1400 hours, okay, 1400 hours. All right, the shadow will fall on the southeast because your sun is on the west. All right, so it'll fall on the southeast. If it's 12 o'clock where it's overhead, all right, it'll be slightly south, but you won't get much shadows. And if it's 1000 hours, all right, the sun will actually shine and send the shadow on the southwest. So determined by the position of the sun and the time of the day, you will have your sun shining and the shadows will be cast in different directions on your photograph. So you can actually work out if the shadow is at on the southeast, you know the photograph was taken at 1400 hours. If it's on the southwest, it was taken at 1000 hours. Okay, let's go on. Okay, so we looked at shadows. Let's look at shape. Shapes also play a big part in determining whether what feature it is, whether it's man-made, whether it's natural. And if you look at the shapes, for instance, a rectangular shape will actually give you buildings. Rivers have a long width and could vary. Roads are narrow and long. All right. So when you look at all these different features or these different shapes, you will be able to make out to a great extent what they are. Look at this river here. That's your river. Notice it's long and narrow. All right. More regular shapes, even a regular shape here, will actually show you that cultivation or man-made cultivation is happening in that area. It's more organized. Or sometimes you go into commercial farming where people are planting to sell. So it has a more regular shape. All right? I want to show you, I'm going to just go a little to a diagram here. Can you see here those buildings? All right? It also tells you it's man-made, it's buildings. And notice how well the shape is. It's a rectangular shape. You understand? You could get square shapes, but it's man-made. And you can identify this on an aerial photograph. So with shape, it tells you a lot. All right, in terms of long rivers, more organized shapes when it's man-made. Let's look then at size. All right, big shapes, industries, malls. All right, small shapes, houses. So industries, malls will have a bigger shape and houses will have a smaller shape. Let's look at that. If I look here, I can see in this area there is houses because there's trees, etc. Notice the small shape. It's small, houses. Of course, my house is small, and maybe you guys are multimillionaires and you have those huge houses that look like malls, but generally the shape is small. All right? When you look at malls, etc., look at the size of the building there. Much bigger. So you can identify between a residential area and a commercial area in terms of the size of the building. Pattern is another one. All right. Man-made features, they have a more regular pattern. So let me get my pen. More regular pattern. All right. Whereas natural features have a more irregular pattern. What do I mean by this also? If I look at my little photographs again, look at the natural feature here. Look at the forests, even in this point, the river. You can't really determine a shape there. You understand? It's very irregular because it's not man-made, it just grows freely. Okay? Even on this spot, you'll notice it. Not very regular. All right? But when I look at these man-made features, this little sports stadium down here, although it's vegetation, but it has a more regular shape. Even the buildings, regular shape. All right? So also you can clearly, if you look at vegetated areas, you can also use this to determine whether it's natural or whether it's man-made. And that also assists you regarding the identification. I'm going to go back again. All right. So people, please note, practice this in your books and on your maps, because learning these things will make you identify features more easily. Okay. The next one we look at is an orthophoto. Now, sometimes we find that learners always ask us, so what is the difference between orthophoto and aerial photograph? Please note, an aerial photograph, or an orthophoto rather, is an aerial photograph. And obviously what we do here is we add in more detail to actually make it into a map. We add in contour lines, we add in spot heights. So, in other words, orthophotos are a combination of a vertical aerial photograph and a topographical map. So it's a vertical aerial photograph and a topographical map. By adding more detail to it, it becomes a topographical, to a certain extent similar to the topographical map. Some important points: they are of great benefit because they are cheaper to produce and to update than your conventional maps. Remember, your conventional maps involve a lot of work in it. Here you take a photograph of an area and then you put in your little contour lines and your names of roads, etc. So it's far cheaper and far quicker to update. All you do is, in a year or so, you take another photograph and you just add in the details itself. With the topographic map, it means a lot of drawing and sketching and whatever. So it takes us a lot of time. All right. Also, it shows more detail on the landscape. It shows more detail. You see more detail. I'm going to take you down towards one. Okay, I want to show you this. If I look at this photograph, all right, it may not totally be an orthophoto, just to give an idea. Look at the detail we can see. And if you add in a few contour lines, maybe 1,250 meters, 1,250 1,244, and maybe you're adding some contour lines in. We're putting names of places such as the road. Let's say that is Dave Road. Do you understand? We're adding more information to the photograph and making it an autophoto compared to a map. I can't see the areas properly. You understand, whether it's a pier and things that all I see is a little sketch. But here I have a better view. All right, so it makes a huge difference in terms of using your autophotograph and your topographic map. Okay, there's another idea of a autophotograph. Again, you can see things more clearly. All right, in the topographic map, it'll show you symbols. Here, it'll show you your vegetation, etc. Okay, wood details, you can notice there's a contour line here. Okay, I've just given a little version, and even sometimes the street names, the spot heights, etc. are given to you. Okay? Map and photo orientation. Another very, very important aspect. Learners, I want to say this, and it's actually, I call it a terrible thing to do, okay? Is when learners start the map work paper, what do? They open up the question paper, and if the question paper says, refer to the topographic map, learners then fold the autophoto, and they look at the topographic map. And let me tell you, if you work both together, it's of such great assistance in terms of answering the questions. So, first step, before you start looking at the questions, learners, please note, take out your resource material. It'll be a map and a photograph. And you find out exactly where that photograph is part, or which part of the map is the photograph. Remember, the photograph has a larger scale, generally of 1:10,000, and the map is your 1:50,000. So that photograph is part of that map. Find out exactly where it is. All right? Now, how do we do that? If we look here, we say, keep the map in a position where the title of the map is north and on the top. All right? So keep your map facing forward. You can see the writing. All right. When orientating the topographic map to the autophoto map, find a feature. All right? Now, always have my map facing this way, so my north would be in that direction. All right? As you normally look at the map when you're studying for your exams, etc. Okay? Then you find a feature on that map. It could be a road or a river. All right, align the feature on the map and the photograph. Okay, I'm going to show you on a little picture just now on what to do of the same feature. All right, orientation is important as it allows the learner to use both the map and the photo when answering questions. This to me is very, very relevant. It gives you a lot of clues. Okay? Let's look at this. What we have done here is I've taken the road, the exact road, which is very big on the map. All right. And I've aligned it with the road on the photograph. So I know exactly where my photograph is on the map. I can use a river, I can use a railway line, I can use the shape of an urban area, but as long as I know where these places are, you understand, it will make a lot of sense to me. I want to show you something here. We're taking this feature on the photograph. We don't know what it is, okay? We're not sure. Is it a dam? Is it a house? It's not very clear. Even if I use my magnifying glass, I'm not seeing it very well. And if I look at the map, The map will tell me straight away, if I know where this feature is on the map, it will tell me it's a slime stamp, which is so much easier to interpret. You understand? When I looked at this area here, I asked myself, is this a park? Or is it a cemetery? Or is it a golf course? What is it? And when I lined my photograph with my map, on my map it is written golf course. Now you get these questions in your multiple choice, you get them as interpretation, and you spend ages trying to figure out what the feature is on the photograph, when you can simply align your map together with the photograph and you've got your feature written. So very simply, if you actually orientate your map before you write your exam, it makes a lot of sense. All right, what we'll do now is, I know people, it's exciting, and I know you can't wait, you don't want to take a break, but I want to give you a break. You have a glass of water and you come back as quick as possible. Welcome back, learners. I hope you had a good glass of water and nothing else. All right. Now what we're going to start looking at is the sample questions. Some possible questions that you can be tested on. Remember, in map work or in all aspects of geography, we went through all the theory at the moment and it seemed simple stuff. We went through oblique, vertical, aerial photographs. We know what they are. We spoke about tone, texture. The most important thing is, after you do your work, and especially with map work, is to take out a map and a photograph and practice. And that's how you reinforce the work and you know whether you understand the work. Every time, practice at least once a week or twice a week with maps. It makes a difference. All right. Remember, you're going to get these bigger scale maps and the smaller scale maps. So practicing will make a difference. Let's start with the first exercise. All right. This is a nice scale map, by the way, so you can see a little more clearly. All right. I want to just look at this because we're going to identify these features. And I look at it here. What is it? I can't see much. I see A, D, C, E, B. I'm not even sure what they are. Again, bringing in the fact about, or the point about, orientating your map to your photograph. Now all of a sudden, looking at it here, all right, I'll be able to find the features because names will be given here, symbols will be given on the map. So various things you will get here. As I pointed out again, your names, symbols, okay, on these ones will be given on the map, so it'll make it easier for you to understand. So let's look, number one, at four commercial functions that are found on your map and photograph. All right, four commercial functions. I can use some of them down here. All right, oh sorry, the four commercial functions of aerial photographs. This is just a general question. All right, what are aerial photographs used for? Number one, it could be for your general GIS. Okay, when you zone in on areas, you want to look at where areas are set out, which is the area with the least traffic congestion. You can get an idea of the roads, etc. It can be used for government purposes. For government, they want to look at where they actually want to develop further. They want to look at zoning of areas. They want to look at where the residential areas is going to be, where the administrative buildings are going to be, all right, where they should have more polling stations. And that could bring in even your elections. In this thing, where you look at where you're going to have your different polling booths, all right? And we can also look at census. When we're doing census, to find out how many people you're going to have moving around. You could also look at development, overall development. Okay, I think we should keep this as a green belt area or conservation, okay? And then we should build on this side of the area, okay? Because it's damaging all the natural vegetation there. So there's so many aspects, you understand? And they're commercially related also, because it speaks about commercial. All right, the GIS, the government, the elections, the development of businesses and whatever, if it comes out in your interpretation questions, it's worth 2 marks. If it comes out in your multiple choice, all right, it's worth 1 mark. So remember, 2 marks when it's for your interpretation questions. In your multiple choice questions, it comes out as 1 mark. Okay? Identify features labeled A to E. Now, this is where I want to show you, and this is the most important part. All right, A to E. When I look at A on this, I see nothing. Okay, when I look at A down here, I see exactly the same spot if I orientated. Notice it's there. Notice it's here. I see Addington Hospital. All right? Addington Hospital. Immediately, my answer is Addington Hospital. And I got it from hospital. All right? I got it from my map. Okay? Let's look at B. And I want to take it up to B here. What is B in that area? Again, if I go to my area here, I can see the word yacht club associated in the area. All right? Very quickly, that's my answer. All right? Yacht club. So A is that. B is please excuse my writing, I'm an old man. Okay, let's go up again. Let's look at C. Again, there's nothing on the photograph, but let's go to the map. All right, and if you look at the map, and I'm going to use my little thing here, all right, it talks about Port Signal, the Port Signal itself. Can you see my eyes are going? And maybe some of your eyes are going. I didn't see clearly there. I just used my magnifying glass and I managed to get that. So it is your Port Signal Tower. Again, nothing on the photograph, information on the map. So I'm going to go there. C, Port Signal Tower. All right, I'm going to go on to E. I'm sorry, D, first of all. I'm even forgetting my letters of the alphabet. D, again, I'm not sure what is D. And when I go to my little photograph down here, okay, I'm looking at it and I'm still looking at it. Okay, I'm using my magnifying glass and I find the word customs actually written there. Can you see it, guys? I know I'm doing a few of this, so D is customs. Squeezing all the work in here. Let's go to E. All right? And when I look at E on my little picture here, my photograph, again, I'm not sure, I could maybe guess this one. All right, because it's going into the ocean. But if I'm not living near the ocean and don't have much experience there, I look at the photograph and it tells me pier number 1 written clearly on the map. the topographic map itself, rather. So D was that, all right? I'm sorry, I'm writing it in the wrong place. D was customs, and E is pier. Number one. Now I've got all my answers. Simply, if they gave me five of this, I should be getting 5 out of 5. All I needed to do was orientate my photograph to the map, and the answers come. No learner should get less than total in these sort of sections. Once again, I must say, if it's multiple choice, you're going to get a single mark for each one of them. And if it's an interpretation, you're going to get 2 marks each. Stated simply, you can also get some straight theory questions that'll come out in the map work also. You understand that we just went over the content, like state 2 advantages of vertical aerial photographs. All right, you know it already. The scale, all right, I'm going to write in short where we went over that, is quite accurate. Okay. You can also see the shape, all right, of the features. Not many features are obscured, of course, slightly with a few shadows, but features. All right, not blocked, I'll put it that way. Okay, so there's quite a few advantages, but this question is taken straight from your notes itself that you just study. So you can get questions like this also. They're known as low order questions. Again, if it's multiple choice, it's 1 mark. And if it's coming out under interpretation, it can come out for 2 marks. The disadvantages of aerial photographs. And of course, number one, you can have shadows, depending on the day that you're taking it out on, okay, which can block, all right? Okay, so here you found that it's generally not blocked, but you can have a certain amount of shadows. Number two, there's too much detail. Okay, it's too much detail, it can be confusing, okay? I can even add another one in terms of this one here. Beside too much detail, there's the features. Are not as clear as the oblique photograph. Photo, in the sense that with the oblique photo you can see clearly, especially with the low order, as I showed you, you can identify the features, you can look at the height, you understand, of features, you can look which one is taller and which one is smaller in terms of height, etc. It's really nice and clear to see there, whereas this one is not. So things like height, etc., it's not very clear because you're taking a plan view, and a plan view refers to you taking it from the top and looking at the photograph itself. Okay? Let's look at question 2. All right? Explain the difference between oblique. Obviously, we've got 2 photographs here. All right? C and D. But the first question again is straight theoretical. Explain the difference between an oblique aerial photograph and a vertical aerial photograph. Obviously, oblique is taken at an angle. Taken at angle to the vertical. All right? And vertical aerial photograph is taken at 0 degrees to the vertical. That means directly above. Guys, please remember that these are concepts. That is why when you look at memos of past papers, you see the word concept there, which actually tells you that you can explain it in your own words as long as it means the same thing and it's correct. Because many people try to learn out these definitions and explanations like this. In geography, we allow you to write it in any way as long as it is correct. All right, in this one, we took some advantages and disadvantages of oblique photographs. What's a disadvantage of oblique photographs? One, it blocks. Some features. As maybe we can see down here. All right? All right, behind the stadium, you may not see what's there because the stadium is actually blocking it. Okay? It blocks some features. And also, you can't really judge the height. Okay? It's not accurate. The shape may not be accurate because of the angle. And features nearby may look bigger. All right, like we take back here, certain things nearby may look bigger than certain things at the back there. Okay? It's not accurate, eh? Not accurate. In terms of height, also in terms of size, etc. Because you can't really make out. You know, you take it at an angle and the things nearby would definitely look big. In questions like this, obviously same thing. Explaining the difference, it will come out as an interpretation question, and which would then give you two marks for interpretation questions. All right? Stating an advantage or disadvantage, rather, if it comes out as a multiple choice, again, one mark. If it comes out as an interpretation, two marks. All right? In terms of this, and of course my age goes bad also, I'm going to take out this word, disadvantage, and add the word advantage. Okay? So I'm going to rub it out. I think I did a good job there. Okay? And I'm going to look at the advantages. So to a certain extent, you can judge the height. Height of buildings, isn't it? Although not give you the most accurate height, but you can see that one building, if it's close by and is standing next to another building, is taller or shorter than the other building. So height of buildings. Okay, one definitely gives you more detail, more clarity. Okay, when I looked at this, you can see it there. And I'm going to quickly jump back. All right, when I looked at this, not so clear if you look at this area here. You can see, you can identify certain things, but not so clear compared to this. I can actually see the stadium there. All right, it's much more. So there's more detail and clarity. Okay. Detail and clarity. Okay, so because you can see more of the area. You can also look at even things like size, which you can see that this building is not just taller, it's bigger. All right? So these sort of things in terms of identification, etc., will make it easier with the oblique photographs. So what we realize is that both have advantages and disadvantages, and based on our needs, it'll depend on what we use. If you want to look at height, etc., and look at clarity of what the picture is, we may use oblique. If you want to get an overall aerial view from the top and looking how things are set out, we may use a vertical aerial photograph. All right, so those will actually depend on what we're going to do. Now, Let's look at this one. State the type of oblique aerial photograph found at C and D. Now, don't just jump and look at it. I put these two photographs here because I know that these are more difficult, and I'm going to tell you about it now. All right? When we looked at the photographs, we said that the photograph is taken, a high angle photograph is taken at 60 degrees and it's higher up, okay, at 60 degrees. Oh, sorry, rather it's lower down. Sorry, I do apologize for that. A high angle is at 60 degrees, but it's lower down. And a low angle is higher up, but at 30 degrees. So I'm gonna go through that again. 60 degrees to the vertical, all right, up here. Okay, so I'm a little lower down, I'm seeing a greater distance. Low angle is 30 degrees higher up, and I'm seeing a smaller area, but with more detail. Now, lots of occasions we find that when learners look at these pictures, they say, oh, there's, yeah, you can see the horizon. You understand? This one you can't. So this photograph, they say, is low angle, and that is high angle, which is totally incorrect. If you look at it here, this is the ocean. All right, here you see more of the picture. So it's taken at 60 degrees, but lower down. All right, so you can see more of the picture. On this one, you go higher up and at 30 degrees, therefore you see less, but you see the picture clearly. Make sense, learners? I hope so. All right, so C is actually a high angle photograph. So C is high angle. And D is low angle. All right. A is high angle and C is, or C is high angle. And D is low angle. I just put this question in as a matter of interest. Identify the major feature found on the oblique photographs. Let's see if you can do it. The famous Table Mountain, eh? So that's, we're looking at that feature there, is Table Mountain. And this was famous for the World Cup. And that's your Cape Town Stadium. All right, but very rarely will be more particular like that in terms of questioning you. It's nice to have out of interest. Okay, in this, in terms of identifying, once again, I repeat myself, if it's multiple choice, you get one mark. If it's there, if it comes out in the interpretation section, you get two marks for each one. It'll just vary like that. The reason being that with multiple choice, we already give you the sort of options. All right. And with interpretation, you have to then look at, besides looking at it, you'll have to then work out your answer. Here you got a choice of four answers, and basically you look from the four answers and get your answer itself. Okay. Let's look at another one here. This one I'm actually going to show you, because this is the vertical aerial photographs, and a lot of it we get tested on identifying features. Okay, I'm going to show you the answers, and I'm going to look at tone, texture, whatever, shape, size, and find out how we got that answer. Okay? The source that I've used here, let's look at the questions first. It's the same place. All right? This is the photograph. This is the map. Also something nice to see about detail, eh? Look at the detail of the photograph, right through everything down there. And then let's look at the map. Okay, there's your little town down here. Can you see it? Not much to see there, eh? Compared to the photograph, which is so much detail. But you have to work it together on various questions. But let's look at the first question down here. What is the land use in these areas? All right. L1 and L2. 12. And I'm going to open up that answer. It says, shopping mall, warehouse, or factory, L11 and L12. Let's look at this. How did we get it to be a shopping mall, warehouse, or factory? We're not 100% sure. Okay, if the map gave us more details, we will be able to look at it down there. So let's look at this. And that was ours. I do apologize again. L11 and L12. All right. L11 and L12. Okay. That's L11. I'm just going to get my pen again. L11 and L12. So it's around here. All right. There's my 12 here. Can you see the big buildings? Okay. And that's how we know it's either shopping. It looks more like a shopping mall there, if you look at this clearly. All right? It's quite big in structure. But of course, the map didn't give us so much detail also. So we'll accept industrial area and things like that for the shopping mall. And you can see it's organized. It's huge. Remember earlier on we spoke about the residential area, houses being small, shopping malls being big. So factory, shopping malls, etc. So there we looked at shape. Okay, let's go further. Second one is in P13 and 14. Let's look at it down here. And let me get my little eraser. Let's look at this. It says sports field or recreational grounds. Let's go back and see how we got this sports field or recreational ground. Just going to check that again, P13 and 14. Let's look at it here. I'm going to just pick it up again. I know 13 and 14 is coming down here. Okay, it's coming down here. And there's P here. Can you see it? Fine texture. Organized area, it's got a regular shape. I can even see sort of like pictures here, eh? If you look at it here, or tennis courts, whatever it is, it's a sports facility. It's not natural. Okay, so that's how we got that little point. Again, looking at shape, texture, size. All right, let's go on to the next one. Sports fields, recreational grounds was the answer there. O11 and P11. Let's open that up. Is a school. O11 and P11 is a school. Let's go back to our one here. Right? O11 and P11. I'm just going to take down the 11 first. Let me get my little pen here and take down the 11 first. Right? And then I'm going to take it a little more down. I'm going to pick this up a bit. All right. And we can see there. There it is here. You can see grounds, little sports happening there, the shape around it, long buildings with little rooms in them. And we can assume there that that is your school. Obviously, if I had a bigger shape of a map, it may write the word S on my map to tell me or confirm that that is a school. But again, a regular shape. Again, the slight difference here that it has long buildings and also has like sports grounds and open fields, etc. Let's go to the next question. E8, and what is that? It's like exciting, we're getting things out. E8 says residential. Let's go back and look at how we got residential here. E8, there's 8 here. Let me get my little pen. That's 8 here. And that's E there. And it's clearly to see in this area. Learners, we can see trees between the little buildings. And remember we spoke about it earlier, smaller buildings with vegetation around it. You understand? There's roads cutting through the area. So it is residential areas. I'm not going to go into high and low income, etc. at the moment. All right. But by having recreation, etc., you can see that's middle to high income residential area, but it's a residential area itself. Again, its shape, right, and size, and also what's found around it, like vegetation. In a CBD, you're not going to get much of that, okay, in terms of vegetation, etc. Okay, let's go on. A10. I'm opening that one up. It's like opening Christmas gifts, eh? It's exciting. All right. And A10 tells us it's a forest. A bit of a strong word, eh? Forest or whatever. Let's check this out. All right, A10. Let me get my pen again. A10. Can you see the rough texture? All right, in this area, the irregular shape, because it's natural. You can call it a group of trees around the area. You understand? You can talk about a forest, okay? In this area, the rough texture and unorganized pattern, irregular pattern. Okay, guys, so there's quite a few, and if you keep practicing, orientating your map to the photograph and practicing, you should score very, very high marks in this section itself. All right. T3 and U3. Let's check what's that. All right. T3 and U3. A marina or a harbor. Okay. Let's go. And check how we got that. T3 and U3. I'm going to take the 3 first down. And more down. And here we can see it to a certain extent. We can see there's little boats, etc., found in the area down here. Can you see that, learners? Okay, little ships and yachts and whatever. It's for the rich people, not for me. But anyway, one day I should achieve this. And you can see that there's the ocean there, and therefore it is a marina or a harbor itself. All right. Now, learners, I want to ask you, what is so difficult about this? Again, I know I'm saying it 100 times or maybe 1,000 times, but orientate your map and your photograph. Use your texture, your shadow, as I showed you the earlier one where the map and the photograph worked. Yeah, we're using texture, shadows, and tone, and we're finding things out. Look at this question. How does, and I hope I got it on my pen, how does the texture of area P13 and P14 indicate that this is not a wheat farm or an orchard? All right, P13 or P14. Before I even look at the answer on this one, all right, P13 and P14. Let me go to 13 and 14. Sure, this thing, you're never going to see the picture anymore with all my lines. Then we're going here and here. Okay, how do you know that's not a forest or whatever? All right, I'm sure you guessed the answers at home already. Look at the fine texture there. It's fine texture. Okay? I know my writing is untidy, but this diagram is messed up already. It may just add some beauty to it. So it's a fine texture that makes a difference, that tells you it's not a forest or whatever. Okay, but I know you would have picked it up already. Okay? So, you see it, smoother texture, it's finer, okay, than a maize or wheat field. Rather than, I mentioned the word forest, but it still applies. With a maize or wheat field, okay, you're actually going to see more, all right, in terms of a coarse texture. So again, you can make out whether these are happening. It talks about arranging these buildings in order of height. Here we're using the aspect of height. All right, J15, I15, and L15. All right, let's look at what we've got here and look at why we've got it. We've got I15, L15, and then J15. Now, how did we make that out? I5, L11, and J15. Right, when we go to our... Right, let me erase all this stuff, otherwise you won't make out what is going on. I may just leave my beautiful handwriting here for you guys. I know you're telling me already at home, please erase that handwriting. It disturbs us, we won't be able to sleep. Okay, so I'm going to raise it so we can look at it again. And I'm just going to pop the question again. All right? Order J15, I15, and L15, and I5, L11, and J15. And that's the order in terms of height, starting with the tallest. Now, let's look at why I5 and why L5 next. Okay? And if I look at it here, I5, I can see the great amount of shadows down here, which tells me the building is quite tall. Okay, can you see the shadows in this area? Okay, let's look at the next one, L11. Let me get it up here, L11. Okay, can you see that, guys? When you look at L11, you don't see the large shadows there. Therefore, it looks smaller in height because all is taken at the same time. It's one photograph. Okay, and I think the last one was, and I just want to confirm that, the last one was J15. Let's go back to J15. Okay, I'm going to get the 15 first, line down, and we get the J. And here you see less shadows. Can you see it? Less, which tells you it's shorter. So we go from this one to that one to that one. And that's how we got our answers, by looking at the shadows and also getting a view of it down there. Remember, this is a vertical aerial photograph, so you can use the shadows to a certain extent to benefit and get the answer. All right, so let's look at the next question. Find two rows or letters that show the N2 National Road. All right, I and H. Now, how did we get this one? I and H, we know again, we learned something about the shape of roads and rivers, etc. They are narrow and long and have sort of irregular shapes and movements. And if you look at this, you can actually see it down here. All right. It winds, it's long, it's narrow. If you visualize that, and if you look at, you have to look at the map itself, the map will tell you road. You understand? Therefore, you look at in which blocks it is, H and I, and it cuts across that area going that way. Again, you look at the fine texture, all right? But it's also long and narrow, using shape and length of it down there, okay? The next one. What is the very dark area in parts T7 to 10 and U7 to 10? All right, dark area. And that is your water. Let's get back to our photograph. Okay, you got little clues here. Okay, there's it down here. Let me use my pen. There's it down here. And you can see the dark colors here is your water. Also making assumption there are yachts here, etc. So that is your water. Once again, obviously, I can't just show you. The picture is not as clear on the topographic map. But if you looked at the topographic map of this area, it'll give you a blue color there, which refers to water. So even here, as I showed you earlier on, you could identify various features. The symbol for S tells you school. You understand? The blue tells you water. Okay, so using your topographic map will be very, very important. All right. Let's go a bit more down. Squares H to M, 6 to 14 are core of Knysna's central business district. Okay? Find two ways in which the CBD core looks different from a residential area. All right? What makes it look different? Of course, your knowledge of the CBD. You understand? You've done it over many years, even in grade 9, you did your land use zones, etc., will help you. Okay, your knowledge of residential areas will help you. So let's look at this. We've already know that residential areas have trees around it. Okay, the density of buildings is not that high. Again, it'll depend on whether it's high or low income. Low income will have it closer, right? But smaller buildings, shorter buildings, the CBD is where the central business district with all this commercial activity happening there all the time will have far more density of buildings, height of buildings, etc. So before we even look at the answer, let's check this down here. We looked at, and I want to get back to it again. My memory is going, so I must check which two areas we looked at. T7 to 10 and U7 to 10. Okay, T7 to 10 and U7 to 10. So let's go back. I'm going to look at, I think there's a slight little mistake on the letters that I've given to you. But let's look at the two areas itself. I'm just going to take two areas down here. Okay, if we look at this area, which is your CBD, okay? And I'm going to look at this area, which is your residential area. Now, very clearly, you'll notice, number one, the size of the buildings are smaller, all right? Here, the size of the buildings are larger, okay? Also, you've got a lot of vegetation in this area here, okay? Because people love to have trees, they have gardens and whatever. Very limited vegetation in this area, okay? Very limited vegetation, okay? Density, closer buildings, less density. Height of buildings are greater here because the cost is more expensive in the CBD, therefore they'll build tall buildings. And here, the height is much smaller. Now, one thing we realize from this question is that it involves theory also. So in map work, we will bring in some form of theory, all right, in terms of giving reasons for your answers, why this and this is that. Remember, map work should not be learned on its own. We have to learn it while we're doing the theory itself. Okay? So let's have a look at the answer there. All right, very large buildings with parking space. I just want to get my pen back. Large buildings with parking space between them. Very little vegetation. Lots of tall buildings. All right. Various answers here. Okay, two ways. Again, it'll be 2 marks. Little vegetation. 2 marks. You can even talk about density of buildings or tall buildings. 2 marks. So various answers. Any two would give you 2 marks. If it's an interpretation question itself. All right, 3.7. What is the transport function at R3 and R4? Let's look at the transport function there. It's a railway station. All right. R3 and R4. All right, up here. Let me get my little pen out. R3 and R4, okay, around this area is a railway station. Again, we can see the length of the area. We can see little sort of a station itself. A bit difficult to identify, okay, but we can see it's a man-made feature. And of course, if you compare it to the topographic map, it'll show you a railway line and it'll give you the symbol for a railway station itself. Okay. And the last few questions on this little section. And here it says, sport in Knysna, in which squares is the evidence of the following sport? Tennis, number one. Again, you visualize your real life situations. Tennis will have little blocks. You understand? If you look at the photograph, what do you see tennis in real life? Yes, those little square courts. Okay, let's look at it. Let's look at the answer here. It speaks about Q13 and Q14. Let's go back. Q13 and Q14. All right, Q13 and 14. Ah, let me use my eraser again so I can rub all this out. I've got a very good eraser, so it takes it out very quickly. Q13 and Q14. Let's look at it here. Q13 and Q14. Do you notice in this area, can you see the tennis courts here? So therefore, we can make the assumption that it is tennis being played there. Again, using the shape, the texture, you understand? Okay, let's look at the next one. Rugby and soccer. Rugby or soccer. P13 and P14. Let's look at it here. P13 and P14. And we're talking about this little area here. Okay, you can see it's a larger, it's not divided into little blocks or rectangles like this, which shows us tennis courts, but it's a bigger area, okay, showing you the sports field there. And that is why we're not sure, we can't see the rugby or soccer poles clearly, so we can say it's either rugby or soccer itself. Next one. Cricket, in which area is that? And we look at this, we look at 01 and 02. All right, looking at 01 and 02. In this area here. 01 and 02. And if you, may not show very clearly on the television, but if you look here, you clearly see a cricket pitch being shown. Okay, so we work out as cricket again, shape. In the middle, a cricket pitch tells us it's cricket. All right, sailing. Let me get to my pen. T2, T3, T U2, U3, and this is an easy one, eh? Because if you look at here, all these areas, the yachts, etc., are there. So obviously there's sailing happening in those areas itself. Once again, using the picture, using our knowledge, using the topographic map, makes it so much easier to find. All right? Okay, guys, let's look at the next one. This is a few on your autophoto itself. Now, guys, again, I'm emphasizing the point, learners, and that is orientating your photograph to your map. And I think I did go over that early on, but I wish to go over it again. The first one here, or the features itself here, says, refer to the photograph, locate area mark P3 on the photograph. Oh, sorry, let me go back here. I do apologize for that. Identify the following features on the autophoto map. You would never know what that is in terms of number 7. You're not clear at all. Again, if you compare it to the map, it was a map of Rustenburg, and I'm sure your teachers will have one there. It was set in one of the prelim exams. So if you look at this map and look at 7 on the photograph or the orthophoto, and look at 7, if you orientated your map, it's actually a slimes dam. Number 12, as I mentioned earlier, okay, you can see little trees, you weren't sure, but when you orientated it, it is a golf course. I want to write that again on top. Slimes Dam and golf course. Okay, this one, nice one, eh? If it's next to the roads, okay, it's covering a lot of vertical extent. Okay, on the map, it'll show you as black little blocks, not little, I would say, but elongated ones that are lying in the area. Okay, close to bulk transport on the outskirts. Okay, and if you looked at your map also together with this, your topographic map, you'll notice that is an industrial area. Okay, and the next one, it says, locate area mark 3. Just out of interest, and we may not do so much on the income and the low income or high income areas, etc. And it says, this area is an informal settlement. So obviously, if you get something like this popping up, we have to give you an idea if we haven't dealt with sort of high income, low end identification. Okay? Informal settlement. All right, the old concept that you used to use before was the squatter camp, but the more the appropriate concept is informal settlement. Give one piece of evidence from the orthophoto map to suggest that this statement is true. Okay? Right, now, if we look at this and we look at the area, what do we notice? Number one, very small houses. Also very, very close to one another. Okay? Very close to one another. Although there is infrastructure, the houses don't seem to be organized very well. And some of them to a certain extent have a irregular shape. And some of them are hanging out here and here, there's no definite pattern. So the high density, the tiny little houses, and some of them have irregular shapes, also lack of recreational facilities, a lack of vegetation to a certain extent. All these sort of answers will come up to tell you that this is actually a informal settlement. But obviously questions like this, well, what you call it is give you a little clue if you haven't done the section itself. Learners, map work, especially this aerial photographs that I've been going through with you today, is simple stuff if you practice. Remember my tip again? Number one, before you start a paper, orientate your photograph to the map. Make sure you know where it is so that you can identify features. Secondly, if you've got an eye problem, please, a magnifying glass, like me, okay? I sometimes don't like putting my glasses on because I make a spectacle of myself, so I use my magnifying glass. Third is, beside revising, don't treat it like theory, beside revising over your work, you understand, and studying the notes, each week you must take out a map and photograph and practice with it, because practice makes perfect. And in your class, your teachers will be doing it this way. When they teach the theory section, they will be teaching the map work. If not, you can ask them, but how does this fit into map work, or if it fits into map work? Learners, I hope that this session has sort of informed you more about aerial photographs and the approach to aerial photographs. And I'm looking forward to you grade 11s and whoever else is watching to score total for this section, because you can. All the best and good luck.